All right, well, today we're talking about wikis, and I'll explain a little bit more about that. Basically, it's a tool that allows collaboration between people, even when they're not working in the same office space. So this is a particularly useful tool for committee groups, which, being Presbyterians, we know all about committees. Oh, just a reminder, I've got everybody off mute, so if you can go ahead and mute your phone on your end, so I don't get any background noise. Then if you've got any question, go ahead and unmute yourself and just jump right in with your question, or go ahead and pop it up in the question box. Okay, so anyway, what we're going to talk about today, we're going to look at some project management basics, and I'm just going to spend a little bit of time on that because that helps set the frame for how useful this tool is. We'll talk about what a wiki is, how it can save your church time, and how it can help speed up project work. And then we're going to be looking at some specific features of Google Sites, which is one type of wiki. Project management basics. What tools do we use when we manage a project? And the first thing I want to look at is everything that we do at church in one way or another is a project. Service delivery is probably one of the biggest areas for managing projects. And by service, I'm not talking about just the Sunday service, although that certainly can be a project in and of itself. But any service or ministry that a church provides can be viewed as a project. That can be your vacation Bible school. That can be operating a food pantry, or if you work in an area of high unemployment, if you have a jobs retraining program or counseling services you provide, all of these things are services that need to be delivered and in some way managed, even if they're currently managed in an informal way. Community awareness and promotion, and by that I mean the awareness of your church in the community, of people aware where you're located, when your service times are, what kind of ministries you provide. This is also a project that needs to be managed. It's a much larger one of a more ongoing nature. And we also have recruiting volunteers and developing them, keeping them motivated and working in your ministries or helping them find ministries they can be involved in. Raising funds for a lot of churches, raising funds, you think of building capital campaigns, building funds. But also even simple things like, we're having the car wash or the bake sale to raise money for our high school kids' mission trip this summer. Those are projects that need to be managed as well. As long as, internal upgrades of technology in your church or even improving processes, just making it more efficient the way you do things. So all I'm trying to point out here is that while you might not think of these things traditionally as projects, pretty much everything that goes on within a church in one way or another is somehow a project. And so the better we manage those projects, the better use we have of our resources, both our financial resources, but also the time of our staff and volunteers. Now looking at some of the tools that we use in projects. Now, in the upper left-hand corner here, we've got the to-do list, the cornerstone of all projects. Whether it's a to-do list you keep in your head or it's something that's written down, we need to know what is going to get done in this project. We also need to know when things get done, because some of these projects are just things we do from week to week, and so there's really no time frame for them other than we start on a certain day and we end a week later. Other projects are more like, this is going to begin at the beginning of this year and we're going to have it finished by summer, or maybe it's a larger project. But we need to know what are the milestones along the way so we can keep track of whether our project is ahead or behind schedule. Very few people use a Rolodex these days, but everyone has some kind of contact list, whether it's your a printed page of volunteer phone numbers, if you keep track of them in your smartphone or on Outlook or whatever other computer program you have. In some way, we need to keep track of the people who are involved in the project so we can contact them when we need their input. And then finally, the file cabinet, the big storage space that we have for all of these papers. So we need some kind of place where we can collect all of our project paperwork so it's in one place so people can readily access it. Because if you can't find paper, you end up wasting your time or volunteers' time trying to track down the paper that they need. So there's got to be some kind of storage mechanism for our project documents. Also, in committee work, committees can't operate without meetings, and I just want to walk you through the traditional meeting process. We're all familiar with it, but just so again, we know where we're coming from here. With a traditional meeting, First off, after we determine what we need to talk about and who needs to be involved, we then have to figure out when we're going to meet. And that sometimes can be a project in and of itself, just trying to manage all the phone calls and emails and deciding when people are available so that we can all get together. Somebody then has to create an agenda for the meeting so we know what we're talking about and what order we're going to talk about them. The list is then distributed, usually by email. Finally, down in the lower right-hand corner there, we meet. And one person has to volunteer to be distracted during the meeting so they can take the meeting minutes, which they then type up and then email to everybody else. We have a record of what it is that we met to discuss and talk about. This is the way meetings have been done, and I want to help point out that wikis can be a way that we can then make this process a lot more efficient and a lot less work for everyone. Some of the pitfalls of meetings, first off, the very first box we started with there, finding out when people can meet. Schedule conflicts can delay how soon project team members can get together. Also, facility constraints can delay how soon the time can meet, how soon the team can meet. Story, when I was working with a client, it was a Tuesday afternoon, and I knew I needed to schedule a meeting, and I needed six other people in this meeting to review these two documents. So I sent out the meeting notice, I looked at everybody's Outlook calendar, and the first time I found out we could meet would be Friday morning. So we're already delayed 3 days. However, because something was going on at the site there, all of the meeting rooms, including the lunchroom, were all tied up that Thursday and that Friday. So now we couldn't meet until Monday, except that not everybody was available until Monday. People weren't available until Tuesday. So the entire project was delayed 1 week because I couldn't get everybody together and because I couldn't find a place for us to meet, including the lunchroom, for an entire week. So that's one of the problems with in-person meetings. Also, weather or facility issues can cause meetings to be completely canceled, even though you get it all set up. And it's particularly frustrating when you've got these meetings set up, a week or two or even 3 weeks in advance, and then heavy rain, snowstorm, tornadoes, or something takes out the air conditioning in the building and now there's no place to meet. And then the other thing, even when you do get everybody together, because we're all different, not everybody's at their optimal performance level. And by that, what I mean is you schedule a committee meeting, say, for 7 o'clock at night. And that's great for night owls, but for people who are at their highest efficiency in the afternoon, or for someone like me who's a morning person, we're operating on battery juice at 7 o'clock at night. So we're there and we're participating, but we're not at our best performance level to give it all for the committee. So we got all these problems, scheduling people's time, finding a place to meet, making sure everybody's at their optimal performance level. What's the solution to these problems? And what solution I propose is using a wiki. And a wiki is a Hawaiian word for quick. So a wiki is simply a website that you can set up quickly. So we are talking about using web technology to make committee meetings more efficient. So now this is a screen capture. This is a wiki. Actually, it's a Google site. Google sites are a type of wiki that's set up for the Christian Education and Publications Committee here for the EPC. And as you can see, it looks pretty much like a website. Along the left edge here, we've got our sidebar with our navigation menu that shows the different pages in the site. The big 44 there is a countdown, 44 days until our next committee meeting, or it was when I took the screen capture. Then there's also, down below that, there's recent site activity. So you can see a list of what were the recent changes made to the site, pages were edited or changed, that kind of thing. So that's some of the things you're used to seeing on another website. We've also got a search bar in the upper, search dialog in the upper right-hand corner here, so you can search through the website, kind of like the way you would with Google. Amazing that Google sites would include a search feature. And then you've got the main web page, Welcome to the Christian Education Publications Committee Wiki. And here you can just put in whatever text or pictures you want to put in there. And I'll explain how we do that in just a bit. So, now just to show you, when you log into the website, some buttons appear that weren't there before. You've got this Create Page and Edit Page buttons, and I'll go into those in a little bit, and you've got this More Actions button. And I won't go through all of these things, but just to point out some things that you can do with your site after you've created it. You can move pages, you can delete pages when you no longer need them. You can set up permissions so that people have to have a login to get into particular pages, so not everybody who comes to the site can see everything. Some things you want maybe password protected. You can also manage who can have access to the site on this menu, and you can also manage what the site looks like. And I'll get into that detail a little bit more later. Now, the types of pages you create, when you click the Create Page button, this is part of a screen that appears. You have an option of creating different kinds of wiki pages. Now, the most common page you probably create is a web page, which is simply a blank sheet of paper, so to speak, where you create a title, the big heading at the top, and then below that you can put in text or pictures or numbered and bulleted lists, whatever you want to post onto the page. But Google Sites also comes up with some specific types of pages that are already created for you. They're templates that allow you to organize information in a little bit different ways. For example, if you in the middle of the top there, the file cabinet, this is a particular kind of page that lets you upload documents to. So you remember back when we talked about project tools, we had the file cabinet. Well, here, this is your analogy to the file cabinet, is you get a page where you can upload documents and store them so that people can either open them up there and view them, or if they want, they can download them to their computer and work with the documents there. Now, the advantage of having a file cabinet page versus, say, emailing the documents to each other, I'm sure you've all run into the situation where you think you've got the most current document, and it turns out you don't because somebody emailed a later document later and somehow you missed it, or you sent out a document and somebody didn't get it. And so now you have to spend all this extra time reconciling these different versions of the documents and changes that people have made to them. So by constantly uploading documents to this file cabinet, you have one central repository now for people to get the most current document. And when a document's updated, you upload the new one and then delete the old one so people don't open up those older copies. Or maybe you want to keep, you know, just the most current version rather than the, you know, last six versions. But, you know, what I'm saying, you've got these options. Also, next to that is the list. Now, the list page is just that. It lets you create lists. You can define the columns that go in your particular lists. If you look at the bottom of the screen capture, we've got two pages here, risks and tasks. Those are specific types of lists. So if you wanted to create a task page, or, you know, a to-do page would be another way to say it. I like that phrase better. But if you wanted to create a page of just to-do items, you would click on the tasks page and it would create a task page for you. But let's say you wanted some kind of list that wasn't in one of these templates here. You would click on the list page and you could start creating a list from scratch. One of the downsides here is that there is no contact page. Even though there's one here that says contact, it's actually a form to contact the site owner. What I'd rather see is a contact or a directory page where people can put their name, their email, their phone number, that kind of thing. So that's what a list page can do for you. So you can see you've got a lot of different kinds of pages you can create, and you don't have to know any HTML or PHP or any of these other web technologies. You simply click on the page and fill in the information, and Google Sites creates the page for you. Pardon me. So, now after you create the page, or in the process of creating the page, you can give it a name. So now all your pages have different names. You can create that, you know, project team phone numbers page, or the budget documents page, or whatever you want to call it. Giving it a long enough name so it's descriptive, but not so long it runs off the page. You also have the option when you create the page, you can either make these pages at the top level, like the home page. If you think of like a org chart or a hierarchical structure, you can create pages so they're at the top, they're at the same level as the home page, or you can create them so they're under the current page. Now, this is put page under Welcome TA Coaches, because I was on the TA Coaches page when I was creating this new sub page. Or if you want to create a page that's not at the top level and it's not under the current page, you want to create it somewhere else, you just choose a different location, and Google Sites brings up a map of all your pages, and you click on the page that's going to be the home page for the new page you're creating. So anyway, once you get the location and the name typed in, you simply click the Create Page button, and your page is created for you. Now, these are a couple screenshots I put next to each other. This screenshot on the left shows you how the pages are organized. We've got a home page up here. This is for a client I did, Great Lakes Center for Youth Development. And under that, we had a issues page, we had a project page, We had another program page. That's the SOSY program. And then there's that Welcome TA Coaches page I was telling you about. And then under the Welcome TA Coaches page, you can see we had a directory. And that's where you would find all the contact information. So you can just creating pages down as many levels as you want. I highly recommend, unless there's a very good reason, don't make pages more than four levels deep. Because once you start going past four levels, your site becomes more difficult to navigate through. So try to keep things to two or three levels if you can, four if you have to. So now looking at the screen capture on the right, this configuration navigation or configure navigation page, this is the menu that appeared on the home page. So here, if you look in the lower left-hand corner, let me grab the highlighter here. Let's see if I can do this right. Drawing tools. I'm going to grab the pen. Whoops. Uh-oh, the screen just disappeared on me. Let's not do that then. Let's go back to the pointer. Ah, okay. Try it again. Okay, highlighter. Okay, sorry. Okay, on this configure navigation page, you can click on these arrows here and move items up and down. So if you wanted Welcome TA Coaches, if you wanted that to be at the bottom of the navigation menu, you'd simply click this down arrow here, and you would move that down the list of pages that appear in the navigation menu. Now, if there are pages that you want to add to the menu that aren't currently there, you would click this Add Page link, and that'll bring up this tree over here, and you simply click on which one of these pages you want to add to the menu. And it'll, by default, appear at the bottom. So again, you use these arrows, up and down arrows, to move pages up and down in the menu list. So you can see you've got a lot of flexibility here in how you make your site easy to navigate. Now, some other options you have, going back over to the left-hand screen capture here, we're looking at the site content. But under site settings, you've got some general site settings. That's where you can change the title or the name of your website, or Google site if you want to. Your sharing options here, this is where you invite people to join your wiki. Because by default, when you create a wiki, you're the only person who gets access to it. So you have to send an email invitation to people to come join your site, unless you make it a public site that anybody can get to. By default, your site is a private site, so you have to invite people to join it, which is probably what you want to do for a committee page. But on the other hand, there might be a page where you're trying to do a committee, not committee, but a community outreach to anyone, and that's an instance where you would want to make this a public page. And again, that's under the sharing section. And then we're going to talk a little bit later down here, the site appearance, how you can change the colors and fonts of your site and change how the layout of the pages appear, which is actually the very next topic. We're looking under site appearance, site layout. This here is kind of a general sketchup of how your web pages are going to look. Now up here you've got your header, which by default you can install, you can upload a picture like a logo or whatever you want to put at the top of your page. If you were doing a community outreach page, I would definitely encourage you to put your church's logo up there and maybe a picture of your church. But for committee work, since we're part of the church, we know where we're at. I like to leave as much space for the actual committee work, so I don't upload anything into the header. I just put a title up there and make it as small as I can. Now your page content over here, this part you can't actually change. This part is determined by the type of page you create. So again, if you create a list page, that will fill in the page content. If you pick a file cabinet page, that will fill in the page content. If you pick just a web page, then you log in and you type whatever content. But again, the web page fills in the page content. So this part over here, the page content is filled in based on the type of page you select. Now the sidebar over here, this part, this is all drag and drop. So you can just use your mouse, you click on these, this part right here, you click on that. It can drag these pieces up and down in the sidebar. And this is the stuff that appears on the left side of your page. Now, I recommend that no matter what, how you arrange your page, make sure you include this navigation widget. That's what these little pieces of code are called here, are widgets. Because with the navigation widget, people can click on links to get into your site. If you don't include the navigation widget, the only way people can navigate your site is by the links you put on the pages and the search box that we talked about at the beginning. So make sure you include the search widget. Don't delete it. If you do accidentally delete it, you can always click this Add a Sidebar item, and Google will show you all the different widgets that are available. These are the ones I like to include, are the navigation, text, which is simply just a place to type in some text. It can be, hello, welcome to our committee page. It could be, a link to an instruction page. It's whatever text you want to put there. You don't have to include the text page. I like to, because it's kind of, like I said, is in addition to the home page, it's kind of always a welcome reminder of where you can find other information, which is how I use it. The countdown widget, I just kind of like this one. Now, you can, what you do with this is you put in a date and a name of an event, and it will display a countdown to that date with, right below that, the name of the event that you're counting down toward. Now, with committees have lots of projects. It'd be nice if you could actually have a countdown for each project, but you can only pick one. What I typically do is I put a countdown to the next committee meeting. So, because they can go into each project page then and look at when the project is due, if it does indeed have a due date. So that's why that's how I use the countdown. But again, now if your committee meetings are always the first Tuesday of every month, you don't really need the countdown because that's so regularly scheduled, people just know it's the first Tuesday. So you wouldn't really need a countdown widget. Again, it's up to you however you want to use it. Editing your pages. Now, I've talked about that after you create a page, you can log in and edit the page. Up in the upper right-hand corner here, that's where your Edit Page button appears. So when you click on the Edit Page button, you see the text of your page down below. Then you also see all of these editing tools here that I'm highlighting. As you can see, they look a lot like the editing tools you see in Microsoft Word, OpenOffice Writer, or any of the other popular word processors that are out there. This is where you can highlight pieces of text, you can change the size, you can bold it, underline it, you can add hyperlinks to other websites or other pages in your site, you can add numbered and bulleted lists, you can left and right justify, so all these different formatting controls are available to you. And then down below here, it's kind of hard to see, there's a gray line around here. This is where you type in the name of your page if you want to change the name of it. And this is where you can type in any kind of text that you want, or you can use the insert menu to insert pictures in here. So this is all, this is the web page template, web page template that we had talked about earlier, where you can just put any kind of information out here that you want. And again, over here you see your sidebar items that we talked about. This is the navigation widget up here. And there's no line that separates it, but right about here is where the navigation widget separates from the countdown widget. Okay, so now that we've seen how traditional meetings are put together, how traditional projects are managed, and what a wiki is, let's look at how we can use the wiki then to make the committee project work easier. First thing, let's look at meetings. Okay, in the past, as I described, you have to schedule a meeting, put together an agenda, get it all distributed, get everybody together, type up the minutes, and then go back to do the work. With a wiki meeting, you can now create an agenda, which is really nothing more than a set of to-do list items or discussion questions. You can create a discussion page and begin your discussions there. You can then create a to-do list, one of those specialized lists, and put all the to-do items there and assign them to different people. And as you assign them, they get an email saying that a task has been assigned to you. You can also assign due dates, and so now everybody's free to log in whenever it's convenient for them, whether that's work or home, during the day, weekend, whatever. They can then update the status, I'm a third done, I'm 50% done, I'm all done with this particular task. And so as the work gets done, now there's no need to type up any meeting minutes either, because the agenda has become the minutes. As to-do list items are done and as topics are discussed, the meeting, quote-unquote, has happened, and when all the discussions are done and the tasks are complete, the minutes are now then complete. So, and then if there's documents that need to be reviewed again, you upload them to a file cabinet page, you save them there, you can have comments below the file cabinet. People make comments on the document. Whoever's in charge of the document then makes updates to the documents based on the comments. So this is how a meeting occurs in the wiki. And by the way, I just want to clarify that this is a tool used to make committee work happen faster. It is no way meant to replace person-to-person meetings, because there are definitely times when you need those person-to-person meetings. At the beginning of a project, even actually the first two meetings, I would suggest meeting face-to-face to get you to each other, you recognize energy levels, their inflection, how they use vocabulary. That makes these online discussions much easier and much less prone to misinterpretation. Also, it's easier to work with people you know, and you get to know them by meeting them person-to-person. But if you've got projects that go on for a longer period of time, now you can set meetings up between in-person meetings that occur through the wiki. So the wiki lets committee work continue to happen between committee meetings. Perfect example, the Christian Education and Publications Committee that I'm part of, we physically meet only 3 times a year. That's our 2 committee meetings plus our General Assembly in June. Our longest span of not meeting together, we have a meeting in September, and then we don't meet again until near the end of March. And so there's more than 5 months that goes by before we actually see each other. That's a long time to not get any work done. So we use the wiki or the Google site to post documents, and usually what we're doing is we're posting documents for review, and we'll leave the review comments for each other. Now, the other advantage of doing this work between the committee meetings, in addition to making the meeting, the committee work continue to progress at a faster pace because the work is getting done online, is that now when you meet, you can spend more time doing strategic planning, more forward thinking, brainstorming, things that are really useful to do and can only really be done when you're physically present with each other. And less of the report out, record keeping type of work is now done online rather than in person. It's a way to really value and honor people's time, particularly volunteers, by letting them do this work online and then doing the more collaborative and creative work together. The additional benefits of meeting online in a wiki, as I mentioned, the agenda becomes the meeting minutes. Announcements page, or some of you might be used to calling them forums or bulletin boards, they capture all the non-committee communications or non-meeting we used to have between the meetings. Again, we're freeing up resources. We didn't have to have a conference room. We were more respectful of people's time because they didn't have to drive to a meeting. And the more geographically dispersed your organization, your church is, the more of a benefit these wikis are to you. Some clients that I've worked with in the past, particularly two of them, they're located in Michigan's Upper Peninsula, where people are more than a half-hour drive from the place where they would meet for a meeting. And particularly with the heavy snowfall that occurs in our Upper Peninsula, sometimes meetings get canceled or, you know, meetings happen if people can get access to a snowmobile. That's the extreme kind of weather that we're dealing with up there. So these clients, they were very excited about being able to use these wikis to meet between meetings or meet when those times when they couldn't meet but wanted to. But again, it's not a replacement completely for meetings. It's a tool to help facilitate the meetings that you do have. Now, when you do actually have to meet, again, that's like I said, you know, there are times when you aren't going to want to meet. There's a wonderful website. It's called meetingwizard.com. And what meetingwizard.com does is lets you, as the meeting organizer, say, okay, here are 5 different times I think we could possibly meet. These are the days and these are the times. An email then goes out to your invite list, and people vote on those times it can meet. And then you get a report back that says, okay, of the 5 times you proposed, here are the 2 times when everybody can meet. Or, you know what, there is no time that everybody can meet, but here is a time when at least 8 of your 9 people. So the Meeting Wizard's a great tool to have in your tool case. Now, different types of wiki documents you can create. Now, these are not the type of pages that you can create in a wiki, but here are things that you can do online. You can actually, if you're trying to create a new page for your website and you need to get people's inputs or opinions on it, one person create a web page that has that text. You create a page in the wiki that has that text, and then down below that, people can then comment. There's a comment space where you just type in what you think about it. So you have this discussion online back and forth about this text. Then when everybody's in agreement, somebody takes the original text, makes the changes based on the comments, reposts and says, this is what, every, what we all agree to. Everybody says yes, and the work's done without ever having to meet. You can do the same thing with newsletter articles. This is a great tool for budgets, getting budget proposals together before, you know, taking it to the congregation for a vote. If you've got larger projects that need a lot of planning, like vacation Bible schools are notorious for that, you can plan out all the, you know, you can start brainstorming all the to-do things, all the resources that you need, all the different kinds of volunteers you're going to need. You can brainstorm all this kind of stuff online. For example, I met a guy in an online forum. He lives down in Georgia. We met, found out we had a topic of common interest. We started working on a book using a wiki. And I took a first stab at it, and I put together a table of contents. Well, I gave him editing privileges, so he made some changes to it, and then I did a comment. Rather than changing it, I made a comment because I didn't agree with one of his changes, but I didn't want to just change it and start a fight back and forth, so I made a comment. Why did you make this? Because I thought of this. He put in a comment his explanation, and I'm like, oh, okay, I'm fine with that. So then we went on, and we never did actually write the book. We both got busy with different things, but we actually ended up completing a table of contents without ever physically meeting. We did it strictly through a wiki. So, I mean, this is the type of ability that a wiki gives you. So, just to wrap up here, we talked about what is a wiki. It's a website that you can create quickly that you don't need HTML or programming skills to create. You can simply log in, create the pages, edit, move them. We looked at how we can save your church time by not having to actually put together the agenda in the minutes, but just taking care of that in the wiki. We looked at how it can make projects happen more quickly, because now meet teams can quote-unquote meet between meetings. And we talked a little bit about Google Sites and some of the features that it provides. Now, I've spent a lot of time on Google Sites. They're not the only solution. There's another site out there. If you go to Zoho, Zoho.com, Zoho has a ton of collaborative tools online. It's actually a larger tool suite than what Google Docs offers. The downside of Zoho is that with Google you can have 5 Google sites or 5 wikis with 1 email address. With Zoho you can only have 2. But Zoho has more document and calendar, and it has better document and calendar integration features. It also has a few more collaboration features. So before you go really hog wild on getting a wiki set up for your committee, you might want to have 1 or 2 people, you know, set up a test wiki using the 2 tools and then compare them and see, you know, which one's really going to work best for you. Yahoo Groups, now they don't, Yahoo Groups does not have as many collaborative tools in terms of document and information sharing, but in terms of online collaboration, they've integrated chat in there, they've got forums, a much more robust forums solution built in. So committee is more about conversation and idea generation rather than information generation, Yahoo Groups might be a tool you want to look at. Now this is great for like arts teams. If you've got a drama team, video team, music team, a Yahoo Group might actually be a better solution for you than either Google or Zoho. So just things to consider. Homework. So what I'd like you to do is brainstorm either on your own or better off if you can do it with a team. Think of all the committees that your church has, and that's both the formal and informal, because you know the formal committees, there's usually an elder involved, but when you've got informal committees, which ministries have developed or people who just meet to do a particular task and no one's really, unfortunately, mentoring or overseeing that. But list all of those, and then list all the projects that go on your church, and by your projects, temporary and seasonal. Vacation Bible School, I've mentioned that a few times. Grounds maintenance, that's certainly a project. Developing Sunday school curriculum, that's a project. So really think about all the activities that go on with your church. And now that you've got all these committees and all of these projects, identify which ones you think have difficulty finding time to meet, either because they're so geographically far apart or time commitments or schedules, whatever it's difficult. And you'll probably find that probably more than half of your teams have difficulty finding time when they can all meet together, especially the larger the team, the more difficult getting those schedules reconciled together will be. And then these become your prime candidates for getting the most use out of a wiki. And then finally, we need to recruit two or more technologists to create the wikis and provide the training. Because while some of these people are very good at what they do in the committee, they're not real computer savvy or maybe have technophobia. And so you need to find somebody who really enjoys technology, who can go in and create these sites for them. You need to really find someone who's not so much computer skilled, but has a good listening ear, who can listen to the needs of the committee and make sure they design a wiki that's really going to facilitate the committee, not based on what they think they need, but what on the committee is saying that they need. And then also provide them some training. And training can include watching the recording of this presentation, or maybe providing some one-on-one, hands-on tutorial how to create and edit pages. Because once people learn how to create and edit pages, that's 80% of the information they need to be working in a wiki. So that's what I'd like you to do. And then I would really love some feedback, too. Shoot me back an email and let me know how this is working for you. Like I said, we're just starting to do this with the CE&P committee, and we're finding this is really, really helping us out. But again, the more geographically dispersed your team, the bigger the benefit you're going to get from a wiki. If you've got three people on the committee who all happen to live on the same neighborhood street, they're probably going to find it a lot easier just to go knock on each other's door than try to put together a wiki. Just to let you know what's coming up, today's presentation was delayed a week for a variety of reasons. So our next presentation will be next week. I'm going to be talking about blogging and hybrid sites. So if your church is considering blogging or wants some tips on blogging, this is a good presentation. If your church is looking for a good website management solution, you want to have a website that anybody can update without having to know HTML, this is definitely going to be a column that you'll want to listen in on. At the end of this month, I'll be talking about creating a communications team, how to recruit volunteers onto your team, how to keep them motivated, and how to keep them focused on their tasks. And that's going to be the cornerstone or foundation for the four-part series that I'm going to do starting in September. I'm going to go to doing just one webinar a month in September, and each month I'm going to talk about a different aspect of developing a whole communications plan for your church from beginning to end, starting with what does it mean to have a communications plan and what can it do for your church, and we'll finish it up with how to actually use particular tools to implement your communication solutions. So that's it. That's all I have. I've got everybody on unmute, so I'm opening up the microphones for your questions. So it's turn the microphone over to you for the next 18 minutes.
Okay.